I'm Hal Higdon, Chancellor of Ozarks Technical Community College. It's my pleasure to welcome you to the 2016 Excellence in Business Award Program. We're really excited to have a large crowd here, and we're really happy to be honoring Johnny Morris today. I think it's a terrific program, and I think you're really going to enjoy it. I want to introduce a few people who are in the audience that are with us today. If you would, just hold your applause to the end. From our Board of Trustees, we have our Board Chair, Greg DeLong, Mr. J. Howard Fisk, Jennifer Connelly, Jeff Lehman, and Chip Shepard. So our Board of Trustees. From our Foundation Board, we have Leon Combs, John Gentry, Rick Hewlett, Curtis Jared, Dr. Keith LaFerre, Ryan Murray, Lisa Person, David Taylor, Jim Towery, and Randall Wallace. If you can give them a hand. Especially welcome today is some of our past recipients of this award. We have with us today Mr. Jim Anderson, Jack Hershen and his wife Sherry, Jack Stack, and Bill Turner. If you could give them a hand. We also have with us our founding president, our president emeritus, Dr. Norman Myers. We have the Honorable Bob Stevens, mayor of the city of Springfield, the Honorable Roseanne Bentley, county commissioner, and the Honorable Bob Certain, presiding commissioner. We also have with us Councilwoman Jan Fisk. I saw David Manuel, president of Drury, and we also have Cliff Smart, president of Missouri State University, and John Jungman, our school superintendent. So let's welcome all of our guests and dignitaries. I especially want to thank our media sponsor, Business 417, and you should see a 417 magazine there at your place, and they're a great partner. We're really excited today. It's a big year at OTC. We're in the ending of our 25th year. 25 years ago, we were founded really from very humble beginnings, and it's been a really exciting time. I did want to mention, in fact, my board chair told me to mention, that OTC for the second time in three years has been found to be one of the top 150 community colleges in the country, and we're a finalist for the Aspen Award, which is to be the top community college in the nation. So we're really excited about that. We're going to get going because you didn't come here to hear me. You came here to hear the honoree. So if you would, turn your attention to the video screens.
By Big Cedar Lawn. Old John L's done salted the stream. He made it easy, but I pulled it in. I got that sucker mounted, and the rest is a dream. Did I hook the fish, or did fishing hook me? It's a little of both, as best I can see. I ain't too sure where the blame ought to be. Did I hook the fish, or did fishing hook me? I'm out on the lake from sunup to sundown, and all night whenever I can. I've lost my job and I'm losing my family. My wife, she's done took up with some other man. She says you just can't look sexy with a worm in your hand. Did I hook the fish or did fishing hook me? It's a little of both as best I can see. I ain't too sure where the blame ought to be. Did I hook the fish or did fishing hook
two
me?
Two giants in the same. Yeah!
That a boy, something like that.
Get him, son.
Man, did you see that monster thing come after that bait?
Buddy, good fishing. You worked hard to catch him, didn't you?
Old John L's done got me, coming and going. But he's still a pretty good friend. He rents me the boat and sells me the bait. He lets me keep me a fish now and then. What a friend. Did I hook the fish or did fishing hook me? It's a little of both as best I can see. I ain't too sure where the blame ought to be. Did I hook the fish or did fishing hook me? I'm standing here with a worm in my hand.
Fishing is for dreamers. Where every cast holds the promise of catching a fish so big, it's got a name like Walter, Big Joe, or the General.
All right, come on up here, baby.
Yeah, he is a giant! My gosh, look at this fish! Woo! I mean, this is a huge, huge, huge fish! My gosh!
I think I'm about to faint out. I've never
seen a fish like this in my life. Look at them! What were you talking about last night? What kind of bass you want to get? What we dream about?
A communistic heathen hog!
Buddy, this is him! Look at the girth on that fish! That is an enormous, enormous
bass. I've never seen one that big.
I've never seen one in my life anything like this.
He's 14 pounds. See that four there?
Yeah.
What he is, 14 pounds.
Buddy, a 14 pound bass.
Hold him up there, buddy.
Porter's big bass. My gosh.
God, John, I can't hardly get all of them in the damn picture. He's 12 feet long, man.
Oh, that is big. That is huge. Oh, look at the wake of that.
Don't you see expand a body?
Hey, buddy! Buddy, buddy! Hey, look up here. Look at it, hey!
Very good, man!
Only 5.5.
Woohoo! Oh, this is golly!
Oh my god!
Now get the mic. Golly! Oh, what a fish! Oh, Jack. That's good, that's good. Oh, great. We got him!
We got him!
We got him! You got him! Oh, my gosh, Jack, what a fish. I got him. Oh, my gosh, he's a ton.
Yeah.
Look at the size of this fish. Look at this fish, Jack. Look at this thing. I don't know if I can look there. Oh, golly, Jack. What a job out of that timber, buddy. Oh, that is a huge, huge fish. My gosh. Bass fishing for monster. That's what this is.
I know what kind of a bass rod you caught him on.
Yeah, the best.
Came from Bass Pro Shop in Missouri. That's the biggest fish this rod will ever catch.
Yeah, man, that's great.
All righty, boys. Okay. Got him on. Yeah, I think he's got it. You hang on my butt, buddy.
I
was about to go swimming.
He's dripping line. I'm holding on. I'm helping you, John.
And Bill, you did a heck of a job of getting my butt right there. Golly.
I thought you were gone.
All right, Roland, I think we're in the clear.
You think we're in the clear?
Yeah. Oh,
I got you. Another whale.
Golly.
Golly.
That's good.
He's a man of compared to yours. Thank you, fish. Woo! Boy, he took off, didn't he?
And young fishermen dream especially big dreams.
He's got the big one! Look at him bend his pole. He can't hold him. Oh, reel. You pushed your button. Reel. He's on there. He's huge.
God, he is huge.
Oh! John!
Oh, way to go. Look how big he is.
No!
Larry, there's your picture.
Right. I can't hold it anymore.
Is he getting heavy?
Hold it,
Dad,
you hold it.
All right, one more, JB.
All right, we're going to release this old bass.
No!
Oh, come on, jump off. Kind of like your first girl go back home.
I'll eat
him. So you could save his life if you say let him go. You know that? And he's one of the biggest old bass in here.
Call your family. Well, that's good. That was a good brand. Anyway.
We'll catch him again when you get older, okay?
Is that okay, buddy?
But you let him go, John Paul.
You let him go.
Let this bass go. Hold on to him real hard.
You hear Jesse?
Hold him back and then let him go. Oop, there he goes.
Bye, Fishy.
Bye, Fishy.
Way to go, buddy. Give me five.
God, what a whale.
Brought it by now. Let him go if you need to. God, what a fish. All right, let's take it easy. Easy, boys. Let's take your time. Let's get him.
Yeah!
Oh,
unbelievable! What a fly!
Way to go, buddy. World record try for you, buddy.
Awesome, guys.
Boys, way to go. What a fish. Look at that. Look how far we started. We ran like a quarter of a mile. You fought it like a pro.
16 and a half pounds. That was great. What a beauty, huh?
I tell you why I can't find you. Every time I go out to your place, you
fishing.
Get him in the boat. Holy moly.
I'm fishing. I'm real gone. You ain't working anymore.
Could be.
There's your hole out in the sun where you left a row half done. You claim that hoeing ain't no fun.
But I can prove it.
You ain't got no ambition.
Better
no
school ambition. Or what?
Yeah, much better than school.
I hear that, Mommy.
Weighty pool.
Real, buddy, real. You got him, John. Watch this, buddy.
Shall I twist your arm?
That's it. Work for mine.
John, come on.
On my door, I hang a sign.
Awesome.
Gone fishing. Instead, just a wishing.
Papa Bing, I've stopped by your place a time or two lately, and you aren't home either.
Well, I'm a busy man, Louie. I got a lot of big deals cooking. I was probably tied up at the studio.
You aren't tied up, you dog. You just playing old gone fishing. There's a sign upon your door.
Pops, don't grab it around, will you?
Gone fishing.
Keep it shady. I got me a big one staked out.
Ain't working anymore.
I don't have to work. I got me a piece of Gary.
Cows need milking in the barn.
I have the twins on that detail. They each take a side.
But you just don't give a darn.
Give four bits of cow and hand lotion.
You just never seem to learn.
Man, you taught me.
You ain't got no ambition.
You're convincing me.
Gone fishing. Got your hound dog by your side.
That's old Cindy Lou going with me.
Gone fishing. Biting at his hand.
Get away from me, boys, you're bothering me. Folks won't find us now because Mr. Satch and Mr. Claus gone fishing.
Ah, you know.
Well, there's a sign upon your door.
Well, John's on his 2.5 hour here of fighting this big tarpon. I don't know who's gonna win here. Is it gonna be the man or the fish?
There's your whole life.
Slow Jesse!
Thank you, tarpon.
Woo!
Get him, Cal.
Thank you, buddy.
I can prove it.
What a glorious afternoon. What a day.
2 hours. 2 hours and 33 minutes.
By a shady way.
We're going to go cane pole fishing for 1,000 pounds.
Really?
That's what we're doing.
I'm wishing I could
be the... Go!
What'd you say?
like 11 or 1150.
Yeah. What'd you just say, too?
Biggest fish we've caught probably in 15 years.
Buddy, I can't even believe it. I'm just so happy. I'm so happy. I mean, unbelievable.
You just never seem to learn.
Man, you taught me.
Oh, big.
Stick with him, buddy.
Woo! Woo-hoo!
Okay, you ready now?
No,
not yet. Net him.
Get him in. Woo! Oh, come on, get him in! What are you doing? Donnie, come on! Woo!
What a net job,
Yeah, you get all nervous.
Don't tell me you weren't nervous.
After you tried to net it.
Woo, buddy. That was awesome. Great fight. How about that net job your dad did?
Yeah,
that was perfect, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Woo!
Get it all out of you.
Woo! Guys, a monster! Look at his tail! Wow. Where's that lasso thing? Watch your feet, boys. Look up!
Somebody's gonna get lassoed and pulled out here in a minute. Look at this bunch of redneck stuff. I've never seen anything like this. Woo!
Buddy, that is a super hog!
Took a short vacation to the Gulf of Mexico. Every day I'd see this fella with his tackle box and pole, and he'd fish all day long. One day I went out walking, and when I got down to his spot, me and him we got to talking. I said, have you ever thought about what you are gonna do with your life? I said, I'm about to share with you my secret to success, so you can go make something of yourself. You can sell these fish you're catching, buy yourself a boat. Hard work and dedication, next thing that you know, if you reinvest your money, you'll be captain of a fleet. Man, you'll be sitting pretty down on Easy Street. You can do anything that you wish. He said, you mean fish? Now, his simple words of wisdom hit me right between the eyes. It sure got me to thinking about the way I live my life. Cause I just work and I work all day long. So I ask myself a question that I knew the answer to. Is success a second mortgage on a big house with a pool, or is it a chair?
Oh, honey, you're bad.
Salty air.
Look at that fish, man.
Wedding line.
Woo! What a happy day.
That advice I tried to give him, take him to the top, really want nothing but a crock. You can sell the fish you're catching, buy yourself a boat. Hard work and dedication, the next thing that you know, if you reinvest your money, you'll be captain of a fleet. And man, you'll be sitting pretty down on Easy Street. You can do anything that you wish. Said, you mean fish? So I went and bought some tackle and a bucket full of bait. You can find me here most every day, with my chair sitting there next to his, and we just fish. Yeah, we just fish. Fish, 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 fish. Uh-oh, got one.
Good morning, everyone. Now, can you tell that our recipient of the OTC Excellence in Business Award maybe likes to fish? Just a little bit. Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for coming this morning. My name is Mark Miller. I'm the Director of Communications for Ozarks Technical Community College, and I'll be the interviewer for this morning. But you're not here to see me. You're here to see our Excellence in Business recipient. So at this time, please welcome to the stage the CEO and founder of Springfield's own Bass Pro Shops, Mr. Johnny Morris.
Thank you, Mark. Hi,
you bet, thank you. There were stairs over there you could have taken, but you hopped up there. Have a seat. Man, you're in great shape. You just jumping jack flash, jumped up here on the stage.
Hey, does anybody here like to fish? I hope so, because if you don't, that was probably a pretty long movie, but.
No, it was, and it moved along. I mean, you've been in quite a few places, and I want to congratulate you on winning the OTC Excellence in Business Award this year. Is something you'd like to say to the crowd to start us off?
Well, absolutely. To me, it's a great honor because the past recipients, the respect we have for them, our admiration for OTC, Dr. Higgin, and the board, thank you for this beautiful breakfast this morning. And most of all, you know, I not only share this award, but I really accept it in behalf of just an awesome team of people. Mm-hmm. And I think about Bass Pro, and you know, I think it's a company of maybe these days, and I don't think it could happen in a communistic country, and odds are slim. Socialistic, but right here in Springfield, Missouri, I think many of us are so blessed to live here. It's the greatest place in the world to live, and I'm so proud to share this recognition with my family and extended family, all the Bass Pro team members. It's been an amazing journey where we started, where we are today, and so this recognition, you know, I saw my name up there as being the recipient, but to me, I'm most proud today. When you think about excellence in business, it doesn't come easy, and you can tell I'm off fishing. That's my main job. And the who's the people that have carried the dreams forward, mm-hmm. and advanced our company, and today our leadership teams here, Jim Hagel and all of our team, and I just put them up against anybody, their passion, their pride. And I'd just like for everybody at Bass Pro that's here to stand up for just a second, because everybody's invited this morning has been here for 25 years or more in the company. So grateful to them. You guys are the best.
I'll say, now, John, you mentioned that you know, you like to fish a little bit, and that everybody should like to fish if they watch that video. But you're CEO, founder, and also CFO. Tell everybody what CFO stands for.
That means I need to go out and test this gear all the time.
Chief, that's right. That's just product research, right? Chief Fishing Officer. Yeah. Well, I like chronological. I like linear. I'm a linear thinker. So I want to start our conversation just thinking back to your childhood. You know, what was your childhood like growing up here?
Well, my parents were both born, and my sister's parents, our parents were born and raised in Willard, Missouri in 1911. And I just think my dad, his parents split up when he was three, grew up pretty rough way, grew up pretty poor. He had one brother who he lost from tetanus when he was three, stepped on a rusty nail. My mom was one of 10 brothers and sisters, grew up in a two-bedroom house in Willard there. And of course, they grew up in a time, like all people of that generation in the Ozarks, where when they were born, no running water, no electricity.
Yeah.
And I always think what a fascinating period of time they lived through, including the Great Depression, of course. And I think that gave them a lot of character. And then my sisters and I was born house 683 South Kickapoo, not far from here.
Yeah.
And I lived there with my sister Carol and Joanne and Susie and her mom and dad, always very close to them. And always our family, my mom was probably the best fisherman in our family.
Really?
Truth was known. At least she was the luckiest. She caught some big fish, and my dad. And it was just a part of our way of life that we really had a lot of enjoyable times, float fishing in the Ozarks especially.
Sure. What are some of your earliest memories of hunting and fishing here in the Ozarks?
It was, you know, the Ozarks, it was promoted, and I think as well-deserved title, as the float fishing capital of the world. So I grew up float fishing a lot with my parents, and especially I remember camping out on gravel bars with them, and my dad liked to fly fish some with popping bugs for bass, and just the beautiful rivers. And then when I was 10, Table Rock Dam was completed, and I went to the open house with my granddad and fished a lot with my Uncle Buck, and later on with Charlie Camel and Jack Emmett and other buddies, and I just love fishing in the Ozarks.
So Table Rock, so when you were a young kid, that really changed the fishing landscape here in the Ozarks.
Yes, it sure did, and it was mainly the habitat, you know, and the fish just that were in the river, they just exploded and they became a lot bigger. And
so you're a businessman. So when you were a young child, or anything, did you have any businesses growing up? You have a newspaper route, lawn mowing business, anything like that?
Yeah, I used to trim along sidewalks, kind of help neighbors work in their yard some. And then when I was 10, our parents bought a farm out south of town, and there was a dairy barn there. And that wasn't a fun time. But my dad had this dairy cattle, Holsteins. So myself and another fellow, Johnny Fultz, when I was in high school, two of us milked 150 head of Holsteins for 2 years.
Oh, my gosh.
And it was a very dadgum happy day when my dad sold those cows.
So you were a worker, though, from a very young age.
Yes, always. Yeah, I enjoyed.
But what were your dreams growing up? What did you want to become when you were, you know, 10, fishing on Table Rock Lake, or in high school milking those dairy cows? Did you have a dream, something you wanted to become?
It wasn't a dairy farmer, but nothing against dairy farmers, but that was rough. So I just, you know, there was a bass tournament on Table Rock Lake in 1970, a national bass tournament, and I was supposed to be going to school here in Springfield, and I was, but I was spending quite a bit of time on Table Rock. And anyway, I fished in that tournament, and I met fishermen from all over the country, and many of them were just upstart in manufacturing lures in their basement or garage, and it was a very fascinating time. So I it's kind of ironic, but where Bass Pro headquarters is today, many people here are familiar, it used to be Gibson's Discount.
Oh.
And they had a good sporting goods department. I was a good customer. I kept taking a store manager their list of these lures that I discovered at this tournament, and he couldn't get permission to carry them. So then I approached my dad, and he agreed to loan me the money to put in a fishing shop down the street. And I saw some folks here from Commerce Bank, and my dad co-signed my note, and Commerce loaned us the money to get started there.
So that's really, was that the first time maybe you thought, I love fishing, but I can make fishing, or a part of fishing, my livelihood?
Yes, well, I do. I just wanted to be around the sport of fishing.
Yeah.
And we worked very hard and had a lot of great people. I had a buddy of mine, Steve Reed, that ran a convenience store out south of town. And we got a truck and a U-Haul trailer, and we went over to Tulsa, a little store, Okie Bug, sold wholesale. So with the money we had, we filled that trailer full of gear and came back. We kind of went on the town one night, left that trailer outside the motel, put a padlock on it. If we'd have come back and that was gone, my dad's not going to loan us any more money. That would have been the end of the business right there. But it worked out good. And Bill Reed and his mom, Bill is Steve's son, he's here today, and his mom, Steve's wife, Juana, and just a lot of good people like that that helped us along the way.
So tell us, take us from, you know, you wanted to get these fishing lures, you couldn't get them here at Gibson's, so then you borrowed some money, you got some money from your dad, or he co-signed a loan with you, and then you started selling them in his Brown Derby stores, right? Or you opened up your own shop first?
No, put them inside his store.
Yeah.
Every time we'd run lures on sale, it seemed like he'd sell a little more beer or some other kind of thing. So it worked out good for both of us.
Sure.
We kept pushing a beer over and the tackle in.
So when did the idea kind of spring in your mind that, hey, I can make this bigger? So you go get that U-Haul trailer and say, I can start a catalog with this and sell it to other fishermen. When did that kind of spark arise?
We'd been in business for about 2 or 3 years, and our inventory had built up. And right off the bat, we decided to name our store Bass Pro Shop because it was very descriptive of who we were, what we wanted to be. The sport was really exploding. A lot of that was related to the habitat. And there were a lot of these Corps of Engineers, TV Lakes around the country. And so I felt like there was probably a lot of fishermen just like myself that were looking for this specialized gear and they couldn't find it. So in any business, you know, timing is really important, and the timing was right for us to fill a void in the marketplace. And we did that with this catalog that specialized in bass fishing gear.
And now you did, so really, it sounds like you just wanted some stuff, couldn't find it, so you said, I bet you other people would want it as well. And as I read about Tracker Boats, it's kind of this, the first boat that was just kind of fisherman ready, trailer, motor, boat, all ready to go. What was a lot of the product development, kind of your research and development, was thinking, well, I would want this, so I bet other people would want it as well.
Yes, well, my dad was a real big hero of mine in life and in business as well, a mentor. He was really keen on delivering value to the customers. Mm-hmm. And my friend that's here today, Charlie Camel, was helping us. And Charlie noticed, the aluminum boats in the tournaments were mainly absent from tournaments. And I noticed the same myself. And my dad was really big that if we had affordable boat, like out of aluminum, that it would really be a price breakthrough, and we could fill a niche that way. So we took the biggest risk we ever took in the history of the company. We found a vendor to manufacture these aluminum boats. We came up with the name Bass Tracker, but we had to commit to buy 300 of these boat motor trailers. And we had never sold the first single boat. We didn't have an outboard motor franchise. So we put them in the catalog, and we had to bootleg in engines from outboard dealers. But they sold like hotcakes. It was a boat motor and trailer, everything you needed to go fish, for $2,995.
Wow.
And a comparable, like, Ranger was probably the pioneer bass boat at the time, was probably $10,000 or $12,000.
Wow.
So it was a great value. And I think, too, that the reputation we had with customers with the catalog, it really helped us a lot for our value to be believable and to have credibility.
So it sounds like the catalog was really successful. When did you say, let's open a retail store?
Well, it was probably the first 13 years in business, the only store we had was in my dad's liquor store.
Yeah.
And there's a Spike Anderson that was here today. It's here, I saw Spike. I mean, I think I keep going back, but there's always been a pioneering spirit in our company to maybe deviate from the norm and take some risk, pursue breakthrough values. Spike was our warehouse manager. He helped us. He's pretty hands-on, so we got some welders. We started building trailers, just became involved in manufacturing some. I kind of deviate around here, sorry, but
that's okay.
The stores, we actually, through just good fortune of fate, Handy Dan moved, Gibson's store became Handy Dan, where we're located now. That building came for sale, so we'd been in business about 15 years when we bought that, and it was 80,000 square feet. We remodeled it, we didn't know how we'd ever fill that up. We put our warehouse in there and store, and telemarketing center, everything. And so we spent, my sister Susie, and I, we took a field trip to L.L. Bean in Maine, and we saw that store, and we got so excited how customers were coming there from all over the country, their catalog customers mainly, to that store. And so when we moved into the store where our headquarters is now, we spent about 2 years with our merchant team. Myself, we traveled to visit every sporting goods store we could hear about in the country, and then some in Europe, to get the best ideas, copy ideas from other merchants, and come up with our own unique ideas.
Sure.
And so that's when we really embarked on the next generation of retailing with what we call our granddaddy store here.
Well, and that's something I wanted to ask you, is that, you know, you could just put rods, reels, guns, ammunition on shelves and people would probably come buy them. But when you go into Bass Pro, there's waterfalls, there's, wow, a live duck, there's fish, you know, there's a giant alligator, snapping turtle. Why is that so important to you, to have that customer experience of really feeling like you're in the wildlife, or out in the wild and experiencing wildlife?
Well, it goes back to that inspiration of visiting L.L. Bean and people making that destination trip. And so at the time, our catalog business was doing really good when we started embarking on making a fun, having fun features for our store. So we had some capital, and there really wasn't a financial budget, you know, like what's a payback for aquarium. Mm-hmm. We wanted just to have a store that would really be a fairy tale fun experience for our customers. So we, and a part of it was inspired in our very first store, my dad's liquor store. We got an old underground gas storage tank. Mm-hmm. It was 8 feet in diameter, and we cut a 4 foot square window in there and asked our customers to bring in some fish. I'll never forget, they brought in some big bass and they brought in some big crappie, and the big bass ate all the big crappie. Oh. So that didn't work out too good. But people were always fascinated, you know, by the aquarium. So we want to make our stores fun, but also to make investments in infrastructure like shooting ranges and seminar rooms, so we could give our customers, and you know, we added a rod and reel repair service, and one of our goals is to give our customer a really unique experience, but also expert service beyond what they could normally find with other stores.
So now that's gone from the one store here in Springfield. Now you've got about 100 across North America. How did you generate that kind of exponential growth? And did you think about expanding when you opened that first one? I mean, obviously sounds like at the first you weren't sure how you were going to fill it, but once it got going, did you think, oh, we can take this nationwide?
You know, we've never been real big on long-term planning. We're becoming more sophisticated, but we just worked hard. Pursued passion.
Yeah.
There was a gentleman, Larry Siegel, that played a big role in the growth of our company, and he was a large developer, and they have these outlet malls called Mills.
Yeah.
And so, and I'd made a trip to Nordstrom's to visit that family. How did they grow their retail business? What was their real estate strategy? They were very, Bruce Nordstrom, he was very open and helpful. But there was this Larry Siegel, as a developer, he said, Johnny, why don't you, he was fascinated, he heard about our granddaddy store here, and he came and he said, why don't you let me as a developer build your store for you? You save your money for your capital, for inventory and operations, and let me be your landlord. Let me build a store for you, and I'll give you a good deal on this and charge you a very attractive rent. So we did that, and he built, maybe it was our third store we ever built, was in Chicago, and they ended up building, I believe, 9 of our stores. So that was kind of a catalyst for our growth as being a tenant more than a landlord. Today we own a number of our stores, but majority we still lease from other operators.
Sure. Well, I see you have stores in New Jersey. I never think of New Jersey as a big outdoor place, but all over the United States and Canada. Did you ever worry that maybe something that worked really well in the Ozarks, where we just have an abundance of outdoors, you know, fishing, hunting is a big part of people's lives here. Did you ever question if it would work in other parts of the country?
Well, maybe I should have questioned it more. but no, I think, you know, we look hard. Being in the catalog or direct business was very beneficial to us because it gave us a lot of insight. Where were we shipping merchandise direct to customers? And then there's, you can find easily the database, or where is there hunting and fishing activity, where are hunting and fishing license sold, where are their boat registration. So, you know, people's people's passion for the outdoors in America is very broad.
Sure.
And people love to hunt and fish all across this country. So we kind of feel like there's a lot of opportunities beyond the Springfield to take our concept and explore other markets.
Definitely worked. I mean, you were grabbing mega data from your catalog sales way before Google and the internet were even invented. That's interesting as your business growth. Let's talk about the most exotic fish you've ever caught. I mean, I saw Australia, Bolivia, all over the world. What's the most exotic fish you've ever caught?
I'd have to say maybe that the peacock bass that you saw there. They're like a cousin to our largemouth bass here. Charlie Campbell, as he calls me every week, when we go into Brazil again, John, he loves that so much. But the fish hit topwater baits, and they're just so powerful in the pristine setting to fish for those fish in the remote jungle country, and you hear the birds and the fragrance of the wild flowers and orchids and everything. They're a special fish, I think.
And what about an animal? Is there an animal that you've hunted that maybe got your adrenaline going the most?
Oh, I love to hang around with my son, John, who's here. He's a very accomplished bow hunter. He loves it, and I love to tag along with him. Everybody that knows me knows I'm probably the lousiest shot that's ever been. I'll tell you this quick story. My Jeannie tells us all the time, and before I forget it, dear, thank you for everything you're about to ask. So we go, Jeannie and I, with another couple to this resort, and they had a shooting facility there. So we go out to shoot sporting clays. And our guide, you know, he's keeping score the whole dadgum time. And we finish, and Jeannie's going, "How'd we do? How'd we do?" Well, she knew darn good and well how we did. Anyway, our guide was from the south there, and he said, "Ma'am," he said, "I'll just say this. If a burglar breaks in your house, I hope you get to the gun vault before your husband does."
that's a kind way to put it.
That's true, yeah.
Well, you know, you've hunted and fished all over the world, but do you ever just want to go some afternoon and say, you know what, I feel like going fishing? Do you just go to Table Rock or Swan Creek or something and just throw a hook in the water? I mean, do you still have that ability, as successful as you are, just to go fishing whenever you want to?
Not since day before yesterday.
Oh.
We're all so lucky to live where we live here.
Right.
If you stop and think about it, you're right, I'm blessed. I get to travel to many places around the country and beyond, but I always get homesick to get back here. And there's no place I'd rather live, even remotely, than right here.
Sure, that's great. You definitely want to preserve that as well, I can tell, because you're big on conservation. Within your store, within your museum, you talk a lot about conservation. Did you already always have that passion for preserving wildlife habitat, or did that develop over time as a sportsman and realized, hey, if we don't preserve this, we're going to run out of fish and to fish for and animals to hunt?
It's something that definitely has grown over time. Mm-hmm. We come to realize, you know, the importance of our resource. Not only, it's a shared passion of all of us in the company to varying degrees, but it's very deep and it's very genuine, because our whole business, how did it come to be? Because going to Table Rock Lake, there was so many fish and such great fishing.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of challenges today, but also there's a lot of exciting progress. And hey, if it's not our obligation to be involved in these issues and try to give back to the sports and the outdoors that have been so good to us, then, you know, it clearly is our responsibility, our obligation. It's something that we enjoy to be involved with.
Well, Johnny, it's about quarter to nine. We have another video we can show, or we can keep talking. Your call.
People can stay late and see fishing some other time.
All right. We'll keep our conversation going. That's great. It's going great. Let's talk about some other businesses besides Bass Pro. Big Cedar Lodge. How did you decide to get into the resort business?
We actually, at the time, we're delivering a lot of boats, or we only sold our boats from here in Springfield, kind of a buy factory direct and save slogan. And we got up to where we were delivering about 15,000 boats a year from right here in Springfield from the one store. And so we were having all these families and people come here to pick up their boats, and we thought, gosh, wouldn't it be great if we could have a place down on Table Rock where they could take delivery of their boat on the water, maybe stay for a day or two, try out their boat, spend some time at the shop. There was a sail resort that hosted the first national bass tournament I fished in 1970 called Wilderness Point. It came up for auction. So I went there, and anyway, the guy was, I think, being foreclosed on. He was in his truck with a shotgun in the front seat. I didn't stay very long at that sale. Jeannie found a classified ad where there was a little resort called Oakmont that was for sale. Huh. And so I went by that land she told me about, and it was Big Cedar. And it just really caught my eye, a couple historical old buildings and a great, beautiful setting on the water. So we purchased that. It's maybe been 28 years ago. I think there was 10 little cabins. We have a great art tech in our company. He's been with us for a long time, Tom Jowett. He's here. We studied architectural history like Adirondack's camps. Debbie Bennett, Jamie Keys, these other team members that are here, no experience in resort, but just started from scratch and have really done a great job trying to take care of customers. And it's a part of our business we're very proud of.
And then Dogwood Canyon is similar, just Ozark's beauty, nature park. People ride bikes, hike down there. What was the catalyst behind that? Because it's not the same thing as a resort. It's just a place to go and enjoy it for the day.
That's actually in a preserve, a not-for-profit foundation. That's just a little slice of unspoiled Ozarks that we want to keep that way for many generations and have a place where people can go and bike and hike and just enjoy the nature and get connected to it.
So when people, especially people not from the Ozarks, say they come to, come to Big Cedar, or they go and spend the day at Dogwood Canyon, what do you hope that they take away with them? What thoughts and feelings they have as they leave, the Ozarks' natural beauty?
Well, hopefully they're inspired. I think the main thing we have in the Ozarks that's more special than anything else, well, several special things, but certainly the natural beauty and the quality of our nature and the outdoors is amazing, and also just how special, like I've been blessed, my family could tell in the movies, to spend time together outdoors, especially today. I mean, kids are on electronic devices all the time, and so anything we can do as a country to get people more connected to the outdoors and family spending more time together out there, just it makes memories that people never forget, never ever.
Sure. You're also involved in some golf. Do you play golf?
No, not very
much. Well, so you're not much of a golfer. So how'd you decide to get into, one, Top of the Rock, and then two, Legends of Golf?
Well, kind of to round out Big Cedar, and then there was a golf tournament I saw on TV, a Greenbrier Classic, I think it's called, that's hosted by a resort in West Virginia. And I just saw how that tournament put the spotlight on that state, on that region, on that resort. And so we checked in, how did they develop that tournament and the economics of that. And we found out through PGA they had an opportunity that they needed a new home for this Legends tournament. We thought, what a better way to really open up Top of the Rock, to get excitement, to showcase our Ozarks through the golf market. And so that's how that came about.
So last year when that sinkhole opened up right by that lake, now some people might say, oh, what a disaster this is. Now we got a sinkhole in this cave, possibly a cave, but you didn't look at it that way. You're hauling rocks out of there. What was the first thought you had when somebody said, Johnny, there's a sinkhole on our golf course?
Well, I can't say what I... but it wasn't offshoot. Anyway, but then, like a day later, I found that the water that was in that little lake had flushed out of a cave that had found about 15 years earlier, and I see my buddy Jack Hershen over here and his son Jim. Well, I started in this cave, and it was the most exciting feeling. Man, I'm going to be the first person ever in this cave. And I go in about 10 feet, and oh, boy, I better get some help. Because, I mean, it was going down, and, it could have been like, just way drop off a cliff kind of a deal. So I get the Hershens, they bring all these rope ladders and everything, and we went in to this cave, and it's just beautiful little cave, and it goes back about 300 or 400 feet, and then formation sealed it off.
Oh.
But you could sense the cave kept going because the stream, a spring flows out of this cave, and you could feel the air rushing out from beyond in the water. So when that sinkhole occurred, all that water that came out of that lake flushed out of that cave. So it's got to be connected by a cave system, so we couldn't give up trying to see where it goes. And maybe it'll be just a little crawl space, but maybe it'll be a big, beautiful cavern in there. So it's a great treasure hunt. We're real excited about it. Beautiful formation.
Once you figure that out, that might be another, the 19th hole, right? At, at top of the rock. What's next for Wonders of Wildlife? I know that's going to open up here in a few months. What can we expect?
Well, we're finally going to get it open.
Yeah.
And I know, if anything, it's a big inspiration to us, the Museum of Natural History in New York City. And people get on us, well, when the heck's that going to open? It took 13 years to develop and open a Museum of Natural History in New York City. And it's done a great job in America of telling stories about conservation and natural resources, and been a great attraction in the country. And we're aiming to have a facility that will be on that kind of equivalent. And so we think it's going to be very, very special. The aquariums, the wildlife, it's all about, too, celebrating the role that sportsmen and women have played in conservation in this country. And we hosted recently the summit for really the conservation, key leaders in conservation in our country.
Yeah.
And they're very engaged with us. Mickey Black, that's here, that was our store manager's helping to lead this effort. Mark Schaefer, some really top-notch people. And I think people are going to be very proud when we get this open that it'll be a great facility.
We're still going to have sharks?
Yeah.
They're sharks? Oh, yeah, great. Sharks. My sons loved the sharks when they were little. That's fantastic. Now, Johnny, last thing I want to ask you about is, I read about your wallet, how you had this green Velcro Bass Pro wallet, and then after you met your wife, she bought you some fancy new leather wallet, and you had it for a little while, and then after a month or two, you kind of said, can I have my green Bass Pro wallet back? Do you still have that? Do you still have that green wallet?
Yeah.
Can we see it?
It's overrated.
So that, boy, that's it. That's got some wear on it. Hold it up there for a second, if we can get that on the camera, because I mean that's been through a little bit. You dropped that in the water a few times.
It's been lost places. That it's always been returned. So.
Well, that's a fantastic story. Hey, now, Johnny, congratulations. Thank you so much for giving us some of your time this morning. It's very interesting to hear about your business. But at this time, I'd like to call up Dr. Hal Higdon, the Chancellor of Ozarks Technical Community College, to present you with the OTC Excellence in Business Award.
Thank you. Hey, I'd like to ask our Bass Pro team members, come up here too, please. Jim, family, come on. You guys got to come up here. This for all of us. Bass Pro team guys, come on. Tracker, you got to come up here, quick. Jim, you can tell I don't have much authority. Somebody pay attention. You guys got to come up here, please. Bass Pro team, you got to get up here.
They're coming now.
The boss is summoning you. I don't know if you're all going to fit.
Susie, you're part of that team. Joanne, you guys. JP, come up here.
Thank you.
Marcia.
While they're coming up, I'm going to go ahead and present this award to you. On behalf of Ozarks Technical Community College, our Board of Trustees, faculty, staff, and students, it's my pleasure to present you the 2016 Excellence in Business Award. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
you go.
And you get the last word.
My last word is, how blessed could a fellow be? You know, very blessed. You know, these people up here, they're an amazing team. They didn't come up here very quick, but everything else, they're right on it. Well, thank you, everybody, for being here.
Congratulations.